It's such a pleasure for me to have the honor of speaking with this young lady, one of my favorite vocalists, musicians in the world. She is absolutely fantastic on every level and even greater to work with. So always so prepared and professional and a true lover of music. Well, she gets it from both sides. Your father was jazz pianist, Hod O'Brien, and your mother was jazz vocalist, Stephanie Nakassian. She sang vocals with John Hendricks, and your father was one of our great musicians. You grew up in clubs, listening to the music, being around the musicians, and feeling that kind of culture of jazz is very difficult to describe, but it's very, very real. I want you to just give us a sense of some of the unique things that you take from your childhood.
Right. And I think the first and foremost thing I have to say to people who they always assume that my mother and father, particularly my mother, they taught me this music. They sat down and had lessons with me.
Right.
I that never really happened. I think my dad sat me down at the piano and tried to show me, jazz chords and voice leadings. And he couldn't describe it to a beginner like me. But I think the biggest thing I've always taken away was really the lifestyle, that everything kind of, I was picking this music up through osmosis first and foremost. Mm-hmm. And then I found my own place in the music right. later on as I got mm-hmm. older. And I think that did a lot to kind of teach me also, my parents are extremely humble people, mm-hmm. Humbled by the music, humbled by the people they make music with, and mm-hmm. just being around that energy. I carry that with me, and I wouldn't change it for anything. I still went to school and had, regular childhood, but the weekends and sometimes long weekends, summer, it was always traveling, mm-hmm. sometimes mm-hmm. overseas too. And I was exposed to not just the great records, but some of these great people. Like I met you when I was 9 years old. Bob Duro was a part of the family, mm-hmm. Uncle Bob and a lot of these Phil Woods too. And, I never really understood that until, of course, like maybe my late teens.
What are some of the unique things that are a part of kind of the you spoke of the humility toward people that you play with. Put me in the wheelhouse of some other things, unspoken things that you just observed as a child and you learned from being sure. around people.
Well, musically speaking, I guess, my mother's a master programmer. She knew how to, I noticed early on listening, once I started paying attention to them, their concerts, I watched how personable she was, and she just lit up a room, and the love that they have for the music. My father, he didn't talk much, but I noticed he had these long lines. Anyone who listens to my dad hears these long, long lines of just content, but it's not mm-hmm. without quality. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. I noticed that, how does he, he doesn't talk much. So maybe that's how my dad communicates with people. Mm-hmm. And then people who didn't even like bebop like him. People uh-huh. don't like jazz like my parents. And I was like catching on to that, like, huh, how they do that. And uh-huh. that's some unspoken, like you said, unspoken thing, that connection with people and, mm-hmm. how you program a show and the quality of your content rather than the quantity.
Uh-huh. So, when you say they were humble toward musicians that they work with, what would be an example of that? I mean, humble is a big word. Like if you just could give me a story or some example of when you thought, okay, this is how you're supposed to treat people.
I do remember watching them rehearse. Because of course mm-hmm. the rehearsal is very different than the performance. And so I would watch my parents rehearse. And, sometimes my mom would, her charts are a little or disorganized and this and that. And just seeing how flustered she would get, as vocalists, we do get really flustered around we're all musicians, but the instrumentalist. Mm-hmm. And just seeing.
I understand you, right?
seeing how there are different kinds of musicians out there. At an early age, I was seeing, there are some the bass and drummers that don't know who my mom is so much. They would say, oh my gosh, who's this crazy singer? And then it'd be bad energy on stage, bad show. And then there would be some, gigs where it'd be playing with, whether they knew them or not, bass and drums that my dad didn't talk much, so he didn't. But they're like, Stephanie, it's all great. We're all here together, yeah. making music. And they got her to actually like get in that space. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so just when I was a young kid watching this, I didn't understand what was going on. But now I look back and that's what I love talking to you about this stuff, because it gets me to think back on this, these important, you know, memories and like, right. Oh, see how they've influenced.
Right. Well, yeah, like in terms of what you're saying about the symbiotic way that people are, the symbiotic way that we, the jazz musicians work together, anybody can influence anyone. So I want to ask you to research your memory, because you know we all have, I was always around jazz musicians. I knew they were different from other people that I met. And I know you have a lot of signature stories. Can you think of some people that you met and some kind of, I won't say funny stories, but just any type of stories you can think of connected to the name of a person you met?
Yeah.
Just two or three stories you think of. Well, I saw this person told me this, I learned that, and I remember when I saw so-and-so, just so people can get a sense of your understanding of the music as a youngster.
Right. Well, as a youngster, right when I started singing, I was, for those who don't know, I started singing professionally, you know, gigs at 9 years old, as silly as that sounds, but I was with a youth jazz orchestra. So, you know, that was when I started listening to the Lambert, Hendrickson, Ross. And I mentioned this story on your last time we spoke, that Annie Ross has always been a big influence on me. And then I realized I knew someone who knew her, and they're like, oh, well, you got to come up to the Metropolitan Room and hear Annie, you know, I'm going to take you. And I was, I think, 11 years old. And I don't know how he did it, but my friend Jim, he set it up that I could go up and sit in on her gig, which is unheard of for a young kid, I guess. But that was also a real, like, we throw around the word humble, but seriously humbling experience, because, you know, I don't get to meet many jazz musicians that I get starstruck by. You know, there's a very few people, right? And most of our heroes are gone. And Annie let me come up and sing. And it's kind of funny because Twisted was the first song that I ever learned. As vocally as, but that's what spoke to me. And so she asked me to come up and sing. She said, we have a very young jazz singer in the audience. I hadn't met her yet, really. So for me, I was like, are you kidding me? What am I? So I went up there. I, of course, said to the band, her band, do you guys play Twisted? Like, of course they play Twisted. It's Annie Ross's band. So, basically after that night, we were friends ever since. And she, you know, called me up the next day and said, hi, this is Annie Ross. Call me back. And she gave me the number. She said, I want to talk about what tunes you're singing and what gowns you wear. I'm like 11 years old. I'm not wearing, you know, she taught me a lot about presentation. I just have such fond memories of, you know, going over to her apartment and listening to records, and she'd show me songs that she wrote that aren't out there on YouTube or anything. She gave me a lot of her music books and signed photos. I just, that was a nice friendship. And then of course, Roy too. Roy, I met him when I was 16, and Sullivan was in his band, and Quincy, and I forget who else was in the band. It was a Telluride Jazz Festival. This was something that has changed my life. You know, Roy always came to all the, he was one of the musicians that came to the young musicians jams. He would listen to the young talent and share his, you know, his expertise with us. And
you're talking about Roy Hargrove.
Yes, Roy Hargrove. Yeah.
Right.
So he came and he heard me. Of course, we watched him from the wings on his set on stage, but he came to see the youth, you know, jazz band play the jam session. And he heard me, I was scatting. And this was at the point in my life where I was really getting into like bebop vocabulary. And I had all these words. And of course, for those listening, that language, music language and language is very similar. The notes are like words, musical phrases are like sentences, right? And
Can you give them an example of what you're talking about? Like just with singing it? Cause people sometimes when we talk about music, person listening, they don't really know what we're saying. So if you just demonstrate it for them.
Like the note, like a note, bop or very different word. It's like the difference between like love and hate, yeah, something like that. And then depending on the context of all the other words, like Like, that gives you like kind of warm, romantic feeling. And it's a story. There's a contour of the line. You hear it up and down. I feel weird talking about it. I've never talked about this before on a Zoom.
It's great. It's great. It's fantastic.
Or like, there's a little more sexy kind of punching energy in there for, and of course the bebop vocabulary. You listen to all these records and you hear the way people play, and oh, that's a Lester's line, or that's a Dizzy line, or something. And
right.
So I was getting into all that, and I was like, you know, just spewing out content, like we were talking about quality versus quantity. And Roy sat me down and said, you know, just told me, I forget exactly what he said, but he was just basically telling me, just remember, like, the space is more important, how you use the space. Right. And got right. That instilled that in me, and that the space is just as musical, if not more. And so that changed my life. Yeah.
Well, you know, for us, when we hear you, and I know it was that same way for Andy's band, it's very unusual because of how accurate you are. And I don't just mean with the pitches, and I mean also with the what's underneath the music, the intentional part of music is so difficult to learn. And you have such a clarity about it. It's when you first really come to grips with the depth of your singing and the sophistication of it, it's you know you're in the presence of somebody that's gonna be for real, whatever they sing, because you have a lot of range. We'll talk about that later. But it's startling the way you know the vocabulary. So I want to just ask you about when you were a kid, you played trumpet. You're still a trumpet player. Are you running
for it? Oh, yes. I've been playing more now than ever.
So I want people to know you're a trumpet player. I'm looking for, I want to hear you on these recordings playing trumpet. But I want you to tell me about the Young Rascals Jazz Project. Yeah. And how was it to be as advanced as you were playing with professionals, used to be in a professional setting, and you're prepubescent kid now when you play with younger people, they must be looking at you like you're from another planet. Aww. So what was the feeling of that like?
I started singing and playing trumpet in that band at 9, and I didn't, you know, it was just like something cool. Like, oh, I'm so cool. Like, look at, you know, I'm going on the road and I'm playing with Richie Cole. Like, not that I really knew who he was at the time. Right. I was so young, but
right.
You know, oh, like I'm playing, my mom says he's famous, so I'm going to tell everybody. Cool. Right.
Right. Nobody knows. Right.
Nobody knows. Like, okay, cool. Who do you know? Britney Spears? Who? And I'm like, who?
Right.
Right. When I was a kid, I was listening to like classical music. That was for me, that was pop music, you know, that so jazz was just kind of this, my parents' music, but I found my place in it. And when I was on, so the Young Rascals Jazz Project is a high school, middle school organization. The director, Dave Adams, very important. He's a second father to me. He started this program. He teaches like inner city schools and uh-huh. got these kids who probably don't have, you know, the money to get an instrument, and he provided the instruments and would teach them like Charlie Parker heads and solos. And I mean, he really like changed a lot of kids' lives. Corey Fonville came through the same program, and that's how I met Corey. And he was like this great drummer, this kid just playing all this. And then of course, 10 years later, I'm like, he's on the scene. And it, you know, a lot of kids, it was really, really special to be a part of that. And he exposed us to and introduced us to a lot of great musicians, of course. And
how did the kids that you play and that you play with, how did they look at you? Like, you're playing in a group with other kids. They don't have that same experience. They're trying to play, they're doing things. All of a sudden, one kid knows vocabulary. He's been in a professional environment, knows tunes. And when you don't know what chord changes are and you don't know harmonies and you haven't heard it, even if you couldn't explain to them technically, they start to notice, even on something as basic as a blues, when you get to the 5-4-1, people who don't play, who don't not used to playing the music, they just try to find a pentatonic scale.
Yeah, right.
And here you are doing, and they're thinking, what is that? So did you have that type of experience with them, or were you just another one of the kids?
I think what's important about being a child and playing this music is that you get into the emotional context of the music. And, you know, making sure you know that, you know, music theory is important, but knowing why it's there.
Right, right.
Because a lot of people just know the theory and then they say, okay, I'm going to get into the emotional stuff now. But you can't like just say that. It's kind of, yeah, the lifestyle. And that's, you know, where I was coming from. And I was sharing that with these kids, you know, emotional context of these chord changes, what this, you know, what I'm hearing here. And we talk about it. We listen together. That's something that doesn't happen enough, especially out of college. People don't sit around and, you know, I'm on the road with Jazz Lincoln's Orchestra. I get listening hangs going. Right. Even with people who have been doing it for so long, it's important.
Right, right, right. Well, you love the music. You know, but I want to reach back to what you just told me, and I want you to take me a little deeper into the question of the culture of the music, because jazz generally, I don't know if it's still true. I guess today people equate it with nerds. I don't know. When I was growing up, people equated it with drugs, and you know, when you were hanging out, when I was growing up, everybody was high, so it didn't even matter whether it was jazz or not, but. It's normally equated with getting high or with something that's some type of late night nefarious activity. When you say the lifestyle of the music, what are you talking about?
So for me, I guess what jazz means in the lifestyle sense has just, it's a truly communal thing for me. You know, everybody comes from different backgrounds. I know it's different from when my father was growing up, but or when he came to New York. But what I've noticed and what I took away from his stories is that, you know, everybody's coming from a different background, you know, especially back in my dad's time, if you're black or white or any other kind of race, I mean, worlds apart. Mm-hmm. And now we're all kind of hopefully seeing more of this in cultural integration and what you bring musically too with you. Some guy, you know, Vuyo's from South Africa, Vuyo's Tasha, singer, great singer from South Africa. And he brings this whole entirely different understanding of what music is, not just jazz, but music and playing with people like that. And that's why I like to play with different trios, because that, to me, it's really, you're so eloquent. It's hard for me to put this in words, but all these things I'm saying, to me, that's what—
No, you're saying it. You're saying it. It's making me realize a lot. Just hearing your perspective. So when you say with different trios, and yeah, Vuyo is fantastic. Give me an example of what types of trios, name some people's trios you like to play with. Because I've seen you play with three or four different trios, totally different repertoire. What are some trios you like and who you've been singing with?
Benny Green, and he plays with David Wong, of course. And you've been with Kenny Washington for a while. And then Aaron Kimmel, knows, these guys really know the music and the history and the records. They've listened to every record possible. And I learn, when being on the road with them, I learn more about this music and find new things that I didn't know before. And then of course I play with Emmett too, Emmett Cohen Trio, which we've been, last couple records. And that's really like for the reason that we've come up together. That's also like personal, the story that all the things that, you know, we've been through, good and bad. He knows me at my worst and my best. And that's something you want in a band, I think. Well, out of something I want in a band, I want the guys that I know I can trust them. Musically too. Yeah. Like I trust them so much that I can actually like let go of any kind of control of the band. Because a lot of people look at me and think, oh, she got control of this bandstand. And that's great. You also in this business, you also want to, or in this business, in the performance space, not the business, you want to let go of control. And to reach that selfless place of, you know, you're purely in the music. And while you're aware of the space and the audience, it also doesn't really exist like that. It exists kind of as this one thing that, you know, spiritually.
Well, I want you to, when you say you trust someone on a bandstand, it's not like being a trapeze. It's not like a dance routine where somebody could drop you. You're looking at musicians and you're wondering, what does she mean when she says, I trust them? Like, what would it be like if you didn't trust them? Like, take me deeper into what trusting or not trusting means for your performance.
It kind of, actually, that's a good analogy. It is emotionally kind of like doing a trapeze thing. Mm-hmm. And that if I'm, And if I'm playing with someone that I don't trust, and let's say there was like a bad vibe, which rarely happens, but you know, if it does, it's really bad. It is really bad. You know, we'll be playing a ballad, and let's say they're out to get me or for something. And you know, they'll play, I'll be like, embrace me, chord. There's nothing, just nothing. It's like being on a trapeze and you do this big twirl, my sweet embrace of you, chord. And then you fall to the ground and it's just dead. The energy is dead. So it is kind of like trapeze thing, actually.
Right. Yeah, what you're talking about is the kind of dialogue when you say, embrace me, you want to hear doom, ding, boom, boom, boom. Yeah. My sweet embrace will you, doom, ding, ding, boom, ding. Something that makes you fill in the space in a lyrical kind of poetic way that shows that they understand.
Yeah, and it's a conversation. And I'm not the kind of, you know, I mean, there's a time for everyone to shine on the stand. And while I am, you know, the singer is generally always the band leader most of the time. And, but handing off, like seeing where the opportunity is to give it to the drums, or, you know, here's a little, you make a singing a line about like the drums sound so good. And then you like give them space and the drum does a fill or something. And then, you know, and piano on ballads, especially, like, you know, finding the right pianist to play rubato behind you, that's a lifelong journey, because then you're also as the vocalist, or as, you know, whoever's playing, you know, duo, whoever you're playing duo with, trumpet or saxophone, we're playing the melody, it's a different language accompanying, like, right. Whether, yeah, a vocal, you know, style, whether it's a vocalist or a saxophone is playing a ballad vocally or right. Something, you know, that's a different style of accompanying versus, you know, the jazz pianists. Yeah. And that's something that's harder for me to dive into, the exact things that I look for. You just kind of know it when you feel it, or know it when right. You hear it with the person. And there's no way to tell until you play with them. And that's how musicians truly meet each other. It's like, it's not just, hi, how are you? Okay, we've met. We got to play together. That's
right. I'm gonna pick up on something that you said. And I'm going to take you back in history. I don't know how well you know this history, but you know a lot of history. So before, when at the beginning of World War II, singers were always just addendums to the band.
Oh, of course.
Most famously, Frank Sinatra, who was considered to be the one where you noticed the change. Then with the recording band, and then with the musicians union going on strike, I always say one of the stupidest decisions by a non-essential business ever in the midst of a national crisis. You in a world war, and you're going to go on strike. Just absolute stupidity and arrogance untold. It should always be remembered is that then when the war ended, the dynamics between singers and musicians has forever changed. And singers became the thing that sold, the biggest thing. And to this day, the biggest hits and selling is always singers, and musicians always. I know, and I don't mean to separate singers from musicians. You did that excellently.
But it is excellently.
My father used to always say that, do not call singers singers. Singers are musicians, you know? So, and if they're not musicians, then they may be singers. They might not even be
good
singers.
Good man, good man.
But it's, do you say, because you observed that you're generally the leader of a band, and singers are now. Instrumentalists have a very spotty relationship with singers, you know? It's like we can kind of get in there with a singer. Singers don't know the tune, they don't know what key they're in, but they have a great personality and they bring a lot that the audience wants. Do you perceive this still? Is it something in the past, or are instrumentalists so far not considered, because nobody really is listening to horns and stuff that much anymore? How are you looking at that from a contemporary standpoint, the relationship between singers and instrumentalists?
Well, it's hard because I'm not really around I'm not really around young musicians as much as I would like, because I don't go to the schools as much these mm-hmm. days. Maybe mm-hmm. someday I can see. I mean, from what I guess I only see what I, you know, these young singers on Instagram, but then they follow me. And so I assume that they follow this mentality of like singers are part of the band too, mm-hmm. and that mm-hmm. we have something to show instrumentalism. I mean, it is different. We're all musicians, but it is a different discipline. I mean, we don't start, we don't have any kind of mechanics to assign to chord changes and the modes. And we have to really just, we have to rely on this. And if the connection between this, this, and that, and if that's not working, if this isn't this here, or if this isn't connected to that, or if that's not connected to here, then it's not gonna, you know, that's where you run into these singers that have problems with, you know, like, and that doesn't mean you have to necessarily, not every singer has to scat to be a jazz singer, but it's still this, the concept of improvisation and being live with that, with the band, you know, and in that space. When I was in music school, I mean, I really saw the frustration with a lot of singers, because here's something that a lot of people will think that I am wrong about this, but this is just from what I've experienced. But I think it's in music schools, it's wrong to put vocalists, I mean, they should have their, they should have a group together where they're improvising together. But I mean, to have like one improv class with vocalists and instrumentalists. And in music schools, a lot of vocalists are coming from pop background or theater, musical theater, opera, classical. So most young vocalists don't have this language, an understanding of you know, what it means to, and they develop it in this, you know, 4 years of undergraduate music program at a music school. So if you put them in with kids who have been playing, instrumentalists who have been playing this music and listening to like records and, you know, for so long, like it, they're going to learn a lot, but it's not like the right approach. It's, there's not enough of the ear training for that. They see all these modes and these, you know, numbers and degree, you know, the scale degrees, it's like they can't understand. So I actually think it's more important to start, if you're going to start vocalists learning to be a part of the band, you have to kind of teach them a different approach. So that's what I mean, that it is separate until it's not.
I understand, like you can't, it's like any group activity, you know, for a lot of people on a certain level, you have to prepare somebody to be in so they can take advantage of being on the other, on level, especially with any type of bias. So you're referring to when you went to college and you got a bachelor's degree from the University of Miami, I think in 2016. And you, is that the right year? Yeah. And you also, you wrote, you got into heavy kind of gothic rock and that kind of deep emotional dark feeling. And you also learned a lot of different musics. There's a lot of culture down there, and there are a lot of different styles of music. I want to talk about, I want you to expound on that period of your life and what you write, but also that you're a person with a lot of skills for writing, skills for drama, someone who has, and as your career progresses, you're going to do so many fantastic things that you can't even see that you're going to do. And I look forward to seeing the different things you're going to do. So just take us into what you were experiencing at that time. You know, the culture of college, University of Miami, you graduated. That's an achievement. I mean, it's hard to go. Tell us about it.
Well, I was really frustrated. And every young musician, especially nowadays, goes through this frustration of like the academia and seeing, you have to look at what you have to sit and learn everything. There's every skill is necessary and like really important, but also just to be aware, just take what you know you're going to use too. Like you said something in the last chat about you teaching this kid who's, what if a kid just doesn't like swing? It's like, well, then play what you want to play. Play what resonates with you. And so I was really having trouble and a lot of frustrations, especially as I was working too. And I felt like I was just a little, you know, just, I didn't fit in with the vocal program as much as I sometimes. Sometimes it was great. Sometimes, you know.
Yeah, I understand what you're saying. I mean, yeah. it's natural too for somebody of your level of acuity also.
I'm a good team player, but you know, I was also working a lot and it was hard. So I got really frustrated. And then my dad got sick. My house that I grew up in burnt down and we sold the farm and all this, my world came crashing down. And of course, like those are the years of you date and you have heartbreak every other day. It's like, so, you know, the emotions are, So I got into the rock and roll because for me at that point, I didn't find the places in the grooves where jazz could invoke, you could experience that energy. For me, it was like ballads and swing and subtlety. It was all about subtlety. And like, I was getting, but I wasn't feeling like, I just want to rock. I just want to scream. And then, so that's why I did rock and roll. and learning how to do it safely too, because I was singing opera as well. And in that rock world, it was like, that was a place where I could bring all the genres together. I even did some scat solos with like distortion pedal. So I was like the guitar. I mean, I was mixing, really being creative, that I didn't get to do, especially as a performance major. There are very little performance opportunities in the school. You have to go out and find them. Mm-hmm. So that's actually a really good lesson for young musicians. Just because you have a performance degree doesn't necessarily mean you're going to be getting the performance exposure at the school. You need to go out and have that kind of, that I really learned how to be not ambitious, like, ooh, like I want to be famous. No, creatively ambitious. Like I want to play. I want to share this with people. So you have to go out. And I found that I went to the Churchills, the rock clubs. Yeah, it was cool to be a part of a scene. That the New York scene, it was what I wanted. I wanted to be a part of the New York jazz scene. I would go up every couple months, but I really wasn't a part of that scene yet. And there wasn't much of a jazz scene in Miami, especially when I was there. A lot of jazz clubs were shutting down. It was really, really sad. Right. People were just playing hotel restaurant gigs, you know?
Yeah.
I see that changing now. There's some, you know, Le Chat Noir and Ball and Chain are opening up.
So I want to know how have you perceived and felt the effects of COVID and the lockdown, and the fact that this is a music that's very communal and personal and all this, but you don't have a chance to really interface, to be around people. So how have you dealt with that?
I appreciate that, you know, that observation, but it's actually been a struggle for me to be, because I'm very introverted. Sometimes if I'm not around people, like that's why I like to play with the musicians I like to play with, because they are like Emmett and Benny and these guys and Julius, they're all so extroverted. And I actually need that push sometimes. I wouldn't have met Chris Bode if I didn't have that push from Alex Claffey, you know. And I sometimes tend to like sink into my hole, so I really work at that. And sometimes what seems so natural is something that we really have to work but and then of course afterwards I'm like, oh, I'm glad I did it. I'm so glad I, you know, went out and did this and made this happen. And with COVID, for a lot of time I actually did sink into the hole. We all did. And we needed that, because we also needed, this was a blessing and a curse. I've restructured everything in my life and my career, that now I see the path. It wasn't so clear even before COVID, you know. I was just gigging a lot and without any kind of direction, just, oh, take that gig, take this gig, take that gig. But then at a certain point, as a young musician, you say, okay, now what gigs do I take that are going to really reach this audience? Or like, so I've been working with new people that have helped me. They're really good. They're really great. And this, I wouldn't have had the chance to do that without this. And then I saw New York, kind of Emin and all these guys were doing their, you know, Craftsman opened up and on the street, Evan Sherman's on the street, right across from the park that I stay at. I remember that thing. Yeah. You NBC bit.
Right.
And so I've been working, but it was all stuff that could be done remotely. And then I heard Evan playing on the street and I was like, I don't think I've ever, all the years I've been coming to New York and lived in here in this city, I don't think I've ever really heard that on the street. Uh-huh. It's always in the, you know, you go to the club, you know, and there's always people there that are around that, you know, you're going to see these people and these, but the street is like, talk about bringing it to people who may not know what jazz is, really.
Right.
And seeing that, I mean, that was cool.
Yeah. And they out there swinging too.
So, yeah. And I was like, something's on about, you know, these people, like these musicians are seeing the value in community more than ever. And not only that, but they are making an effort to bring it to, you know, there's no place to make it happen. So they find those grooves and places. And I'm blessed to be friends with people like that.
You know, you signed with Mac Avenue in 2018, and Confessions came out, right? And now this Bitter Earth is coming out. So I know you're looking at your albums and all the things you do in a progression, and you're going to unfold whatever it is as time passes. You have so many things to do. How are you looking at each of your documents? You could even go back to the first documents you did when you were a child. Are you looking at all of them as a one thing that's a sweep, or do you look at each thing discreetly as a different? How are you at this point in time, how are you looking at your documentation?
Both of those. You know, so it's, I've always been the kind of person that I have like 10, 20 things I want to do, but you have to be able to make it make sense. So I say, I'm going to release this kind of record first, and then I'll do this one because that makes sense with, you know, the, what the people heard from the last one. And then you find with albums that change drastically, you know, like even in style or like, you know, the physical look of the CD too, you want to have one thing that kind of the cohesion, one thing that does carry, right, just so the audience is carried with you and it's not right, just like out of left field.
Right.
So I mean, the concepts for Confessions, the concept for This Bitter Earth, the concepts for the next three records I've had for 10 years. And
I love
that's kind of how I've always been. And finding, mm-hmm, okay, this one makes sense to do now. And when This Bitter Earth, when it came time to record that, I just felt the air changing. And I was really kind of seeing things. Like, there's going to be something that happens. I don't know what, but I think it's just right. Something was telling me, I've got to do this record right now. Look what happened. I mean, right. And for those who don't know, this record has a lot of, you know, this was the Confessions was a very personal narrative, just like here I am, hello world, you know, mm-hmm, everybody's first record kind of has to be like that. And then this next one is more global, kind of the commentary on global issues, but not taking a political, an activist stance, but just kind of trying to make sense of everything and from all different angles and getting, mm-hmm, people to think differently.
Right.
That's I'm really proud of it. I think it was really crazy how uncanny how it's coming out right now.
Right. So what is, you say you have your other albums, you have your next three, you know what they're going to be. Has what happened this year changed how you look at those next, the next one, for example?
Yeah, of course. I was going to save like a record of my dad's tunes until much later, but I think I'm going to do that one next.
I love that.
Because people have been asking for, do you do originals? And I say, yes, no, just letting people get to know me first. And then, you know, I do a couple originals here and there, and I say, you know, I'm going to put my dad's tunes out next because he's got such great swinging tunes. And I love his original music. He never had that kind of ambition to, like, you know,
right,
get signed to do this. So I think,
right.
I love my dad. It's a way for me to get closer to him.
Right. Too. Yeah. And it's important for you to consolidate your tradition with yourself, in fact, and then you can deal with other things. I love that fact that you don't allow the fact of your contemporary concerns to cause you to turn your back on other things, because you don't have to. You can keep writing a rock. You can write a rock opera. You can do a record of standards. You can do your father's tunes and you can write your original. You don't
One understands that better than you.
Right. No, but I'm with you in that way. And
yeah.
I love looking forward to just your artistry and the things that you're going to do. And also your intelligence and your concern, because there's nothing wrong with, you're one of the few people I know that's capable of anything. Like, I listened to the records that Abby Lincoln did with Max Roach, mm-hmm, something like Triptych, right? Which is unprecedented in jazz. And I could see you doing anything from that to stuff that Betty Carter did, to stuff, to things that John Hendricks, Anita O'Day, like, you have so much of the understanding of the sweep of the tradition in your sound that you're able to use it, and you will use it very successfully as you go along. So I think I want to ask you a question. I have two more questions, but this is a question I want you to consider. Is we have a future that we all believe in. It's a dystopian future with an atomic bomb and the return of Jesus to extract punishment on people, and machines and AI are going to take over the world. It's in every movie, it's in every song, it's in every story.
We almost romanticize it.
You know, but you know, it is, that's the future, because it's been said. So you, when I hear you speak, your understanding of the future seems to be very different from that, because you still see people and community and humanity and all these things that everything is telling you that's not the way to be into the future. So how do you reconcile what you feel and think? Like, you're talking about my next record is going to be of my father's songs. I mean, whereas everything out here is saying your father's songs. What about dystopia? What about the future? What about AI? So how are you reconciling the the kind of vision of the future and what you feel the future to be in your past and all of these things?
Because I grew up around, I never really liked pop music. And I noticed that as a young kid, that was something different. And what you were saying, that I seem to be very different, I guess, because what I see as the future is the past, for better or for worse, I guess. But I guess aesthetically speaking, things always, I love history. So I see all these trends that, and I hate that word, but you know what I mean? Like whether it's economic trends or, you know, political activist trends or fashion, you know, music, that things are recycled. And that's why I believe in progress, but I have to really think about what progress means. And I'm not sure yet. I'm still deciding for myself if that really exists.
That's interesting.
And so I guess I'm more in tune with my future the more in the past I dig. And mm-hmm. the more, if I'm wearing I'm really doing research on vintage clothing, or I'm literally looking right now at these 80s, 50, 60-year-old records that my grandmother had and I inherited, or the piano that's been in our family for two generations, or, you know, these things that I dig into the history of objects and aesthetics. And of course, now that I'm reading more and I'm becoming more in tune with the way the world is, I'm learning more about, I've been watching a lot of documentaries on, like, you know, the communist revolution or this or these ancient civilizations. And it kind of just all is so familiar.
Mm-hmm.
How far we think we've come, I'm not sure. Like,
well, you know, it's interesting because your range is such that you're not a throwback singer at all. Like, you're not somebody who's like a kind of let's put on a zoot suit and be 1940. So you're one of the few people.
Suit, you know.
But I mean, you don't have the kind of sticky kind of way that stuff ends up being an attempt to recreate that which will never be recreated. But that you're not afraid of the achievements of the past because you're such a great singer that many times I feel like it's a certain mediocrity that wants you to forget who Louis Armstrong was or who people who wears with you. It seems more like, okay, these people could do this. I am going in this direction because you have a lot of things you're going to do that could not have been done earlier than you, which I think is fantastic. So I more want to know, well, in that vein, how do you look at your contemporaries? Like there's some really good singers, and there are people in your group that can sing. So how?
Yeah, there's a difference between the two.
So how are you looking at people in your generation, in your group, in your class?
Well, I find it's the kind of artists that I really get inspired by are people that, like, so I'm playing with Matisse a lot more.
I love you. Yeah. Matisse can play.
He can play, but that's the thing. Like,
he's a pianist, just so people can know what we're talking about. He's
right, Matisse Picard, wonderful pianist. And he also the range of his understanding of music too. I want to play with people that have the similar approach where when they're doing swing, it's authentic and it's in there, but it's still their own vocabulary of it, their own version. Like, you got me to start thinking about developing my own vocabulary in improvisation.
Right.
And so that mentality kind of, you know, bleeds into the other aspects of your playing too. Like, what is, and that's the thing, like young musicians, they ask the question, how do I find my own voice? And how do I, you know, and I say, you really just listen to everything that, you know, whether it speaks to you or not, just listen to everything and let it, you know, take over your body, and then put it to good use when you're playing. Play. And through the years, you find what kind of your place in the whatever music you're playing. When I say this music, I don't just mean jazz, of course. I mean whatever music I'm playing right now. And Matisse, I love him. So it's really cool to be, because I have a lot of tangents. I listen to, like, a lot of Nina Simone. I love because the genre is Nina Simone. It's not just jazz, you know. Queen, I love the band Queen because it's just, that's the genre. I love artists like that.
Right.
And Cecile's the same way. And yeah. It's so cool to be inspired like that, like idolize, but also be friends with people you idolize. That's very rare. And I love that. It just makes me, it just, it's like being in a relationship where, you know, the cliche, like, oh my gosh, like he makes me a better person.
Right.
That kind of, but it's true.
So do you listen to like Cecile's records? Do you check out where she is? Do you have a sense of her trajectory?
Yeah. And I love that each record, it's like, that's why records are so important, because they track your life, you know, what you're going through, what you're listening to. And I've gotten to know her more through the years, you know, since mm-hmm. I moved to New York, but I just getting to know her made me love her music so much more, because we mm-hmm. have, I mean, we're very different artists, but we have a similar understanding of how to approach like what we like and what we're looking for, mm-hmm. and sometimes not looking for, you know,
mm-hmm.
She loves a lot of the same rock bands I do. And it's just cool, mm-hmm. you know, listening together, everything. Yeah. And I love her. I love every record of hers, you know.
Mm-hmm. So I think first I want to thank you for everything that you gave us today. You know,
I hope I talked about some interesting stuff.
There's so many implications to what you said. You said so many things.
I'm still figuring it all out, you know.
Nah, but it's really fantastic. I want to get a transcript of it and just any of the corridors you took us down. It's so many great things. You know, your relationship to different people that you play with, your how you see cycles in the future, what you think about. The emotion that comes out of different forms and styles. I could go on and on about corridors you took us down. And I guess the final thing I'm just going to ask you is that when you look across the landscape of music and the things that you like, what do you feel you can bring to the scene and to music that you don't think is there right now?
I don't know. I don't really compare myself to people out there. Maybe that's something that sets me apart. I don't know.
Right.
But I think that for me, that part of my, all of it is really what I bring. That's different. It's mm-hmm. all of who I am, really.
Great.
Every person's, but that storytelling, right. Need to just really get into a story and arc it, you know, right. Every show, every solo, every, that informs everything. That makes it palatable for people who may not even like jazz.
Well, you know, I look forward to everything that you will do. I can't overestimate or state how much people who work with you love you. And how prepared you are for stuff, and how you still have that looseness and the vibe, everybody, but you are always on top of it. And I appreciate you spending this time with us. And nothing but love and respect. Good luck with everything. You.